chord to the cloud. There we go. And David, please start our program for this evening.
Ladies and gentlemen, members of the community of the Boston Zamir Chorale, and others and good friends, I'm so honored, so personally honored to be here as a mimalei makom to your wonderful conductor. Josh Jacobson is a giant in the Jewish choral world and in the Jewish world in general, and he is in Israel with his family, and he's asked me to sit in for him at this particular point. He has prepared a video that's entitled Bernstein, the Jewish Side. So we'll watch that video, and then after that's over, I'll have a couple of extra comments of my own, and then there'll be time for questions. So now it's time for Josh Jacobson's video, Bernstein, the Jewish Side.
All right, perfect. I'm just going to share my screen and hope we have no more technical difficulties. Can everyone see my screen? I'm hoping so.
Leonard Bernstein. He took the musical world by storm with his spectacular last minute A Star Is Born conducting turn at the New York Philharmonic in 1943 when he was filling in for the ailing Bruno Walter. Until his passing in 1990, he was astonishingly active as a conductor, composer in both classical and popular idioms, pianist, and master teacher of both children and adults. And Bernstein was a devoted Jew throughout his life. This evening, we will explore Bernstein's Judaism and how it showed up in his musical output. I recently came across an inscription in a book I received as a gift from friends of my parents. It's dated June 1968. The book is a biography of Leonard Bernstein by John Briggs. The dedication reads, "To Josh with great expectations and affection from Edith and Norman." No pressure. Back in the day, Bostonians, especially Jewish Bostonians, took great pride in Leonard Bernstein's accomplishments. This was something special. An American-born Bostonian young Jew rises to the top of the profession, and always his roots were showing. I identified with the Bernstein idol. After all, we were both fellow musicians. We both grew up in the Boston area. We both attended Boston Latin School. He was the class of 1935, I was the class of 1965. Then we both attended Harvard. He was the class of 1939. I was the class of 1969. We even lived in the same dorms, the Wigglesworth as freshmen and then Elliott House in the same entry, G. I was G11, he was G41. And we both had the same senior thesis advisor, a gentleman by the name of A. Tilman Merritt. I wasn't exactly stalking Bernstein. It was more idol worship. Leonard Bernstein grew up in Jewish Boston in the 1920s and the 1930s. His family moved frequently. Look at some of these pictures of his childhood homes. In Lawrence, in Revere, Dorchester, Alston, Roxbury, and Newton. The family joined congregation Mishkan Tefillah in 1926. It was known as the most prestigious synagogue in town. Scholar Jonathan Sarna called it a palatial synagogue on the corner of Elm Hill Avenue and Seaver Streets, overlooking Franklin Park. Here we see Lenny in his Hebrew school, 1931, right around the time of his bar mitzvah. Bernstein maintained his ties to Mishkan Tefillah long after his departure from Boston. Bernstein returned to Mishkan Tefillah to celebrate major family rites of passage. his own wedding in 1951, and the bar mitzvah of his son Alexander in 1968. Bernstein said that the first time he heard great music was as a child, at Congregation Mishkan Tefillah, listening to the organ and the cantor and the choir, all under the direction of Professor Solomon Braslavsky. And cantor Iso Glickstein. Now, Braslavsky was the music director at Mishkan Tefillah, and also the organist and composer of much of the music there. In 1990, Bernstein said, remembering those days, I used to weep just listening to the cantor, the choir, and the organ thundering out. And Bernstein maintained a connection with Braslavsky for many years. He wrote a letter to Braslavsky on October 10, 1946. I have come to realize what a debt I really owe to you personally for the marvelous music at the Mishkan Tefillah services. They surpass any that I have ever heard, and the memories I have of them are so bright, strong, and dear that I shall probably never be able to estimate the real influence those sounds exerted on me. I may have heard greater masterpieces performed since then and under more impressive circumstances, but I have never been more deeply moved. 18 years later, in 1964, he paid lavish tribute to Braslavsky. Before I ever heard a concert, recital, or opera, before I had ever touched a piano, or knew that an organized musical life existed, before all these, I heard the music that Professor Braslavsky caused to be made at Temple Mishkan Tefillah. I shall never forget that music, nor cease to be grateful for the power, conviction, and atmosphere with which it was conveyed. And in the early 1960s, Bernstein subsidized a publication of Braslavsky's setting for the High Holiday Prayer Unsanet Tokef. Here's a little excerpt. It's with piano accompaniment, but imagine it with organ. Lenny's father, Sam Bernstein, immigrated from the Ukraine to the United States in 1912. By 1923, he had opened his own business, the Samuel Bernstein Hair Company. In 1935, Leonard Bernstein is 17, and he wrote a high school essay about his father. My father is a very complicated human being, a man of irregular temperament and unusual convictions. He is a rare combination of the shrewd businessman and the ardent religionist. His life's textbook is the Talmud. He lives according to its principles, and it hurts him to see that others do not. The Talmud is his guide to moral and social ethics. If he is called upon to speak, his discourse invariably begins with a quotation from the Talmud. Sam had hoped that Lenny would go into the family business, or if not, at least be a rabbi. Sam definitely did not want his son to become a klezmer, which was his image of a professional musician. But Bernstein persisted. He studied music at Harvard and at the Curtis Institute, and he scored a gig as assistant conductor at the New York Philharmonic. Then came the fateful day, November 14, 1943. Understand that assistant conductors almost never get to actually conduct concerts. But Lenny got a call that Sunday morning waking him up from a hangover, informing him that he would be filling in that afternoon for the scheduled conductor, Bruno Walter, who was ill. No rehearsal, just do it. He did it, and a star was born. Look at these stories, starting on the front page of the New York Times. Now, Sam was proud of his son, but he was astonished. When reporters asked him why he had discouraged his son from pursuing a career in music, he responded, "Who knew that he would grow up to become Leonard Bernstein?" So Lenny had a complicated relationship with his father. One mentor who served as a father figure was Serge Koussevitsky, who was the conductor of the Boston Symphony Orchestra from 1924 to 1949. Koussevitsky, who had been born Jewish and later converted to Christianity, expected that Bernstein would do the same to further his career, and he should take a stage name less Jewish. What did Lenny do?
"Und Leonard Bernstein, it will never be on Carnegie Hall, the poster Leonard Bernstein." And in fact, he had my new name all picked out for me. It was to be Leonard S. Burns. My heart sank, my stomach turned over. I did lose a night's sleep over it. I tossed and turned and thought about it, and I reported to him the next morning, "No soap, I'm sorry. I will have to make it with the name Leonard Bernstein or not at all."
Throughout his life, Bernstein had a strong connection to the State of Israel and its people. He was a frequent conductor of the Israel Philharmonic Orchestra, even during wartime.
My first encounter with the Israel Philharmonic occurred at a time when its name was the Palestine Symphony Orchestra. It was an incredible encounter. We all seemed to feel with this first program that it was the beginning of a long relationship. It's one of those things we just always knew.
Israel, I think, meant to Bernstein his roots. It was the earth and the people from whom he felt that he was a living descendant. And he was there at every crucial moment, and it was always his gift to Israel. I mean, he always conducted for free there.
When I was there in 48, the war had broken out, because naturally the day that the State of Israel was declared, they were attacked simultaneously from six sides. And on the day they became a nation at war. I played for the troops a lot, and sometimes the orchestra couldn't go or wouldn't go. I went behind lines and played for the commandos, the Palmach.
3 days after Beersheba was conquered, Lenny took the orchestra to the desert, and 5,000 soldiers were there. The people were sitting in chairs, but on the rocks.
Bernstein wrote, "I note with equal surprise that almost as much material in this volume stems from my feelings of Jewishness as stems from the musical universe I inhabit." Bernstein's Jewishness comes through loud and clear in many of his compositions. In 1939, he wrote a song, Lamentation, for mezzo-soprano, using verses from the biblical book of Lamentations, Echa. In 1942, he expanded that into a symphony, his first, dedicated to his father. He called it the Jeremiah Symphony. And each of the three movements uses motifs from traditional synagogue music. The second movement depicts the ancient Israelites mocking the prophet Jeremiah. The melodic material derives from the traditional melodies for chanting the books of the prophets, the Haftarah cantillation. Matbach pashta munach zakev mircha tipcha kadma vegeresh tevir. The third movement is based on his 1939 song, Lamentation. The mezzo-soloist sings in Hebrew. In 1945, Cantor David Tilman of the Park Avenue Synagogue in New York City commissioned Bernstein to compose something for the liturgy. Bernstein gave them a setting of the Shabbat evening prayer, Hashkiveinu. In 1947, the choreographer Corinne Hochem commissioned Bernstein to write arrangements of Israeli songs, Simchuna and Rina, arranged for chorus and piano or instruments. Late in 1948, Leonard Bernstein wrote in his diary, "Jerry R. called today with a noble idea, a modern version of Romeo and Juliet set in slums at the coincidence of Easter and Passover celebrations. Feelings run high between Jews and Catholics. Jews are the Capulets, the Catholics are the Montagues. Juliet is Jewish, Friar Lawrence is the neighborhood druggist. Street balls, double death, it all fits." It was to be called East Side Story. Well, we know what happened to that idea. In 1950, Bernstein composed Yigdal, a Hebrew liturgical melody set as a canon around for mixed chorus and piano, and it was published in Harry Cooper Smith's collection, The Songs We Sing. Somewhere around 1950, he composed four sabras, piano pieces dedicated to four Israelis. In 1956, he composed an opera, Candide, based on Voltaire's satirical comedy. One of the songs from Candide is called The Old Lady's Jewish Tango, and Bernstein marked it Moderato Hasidimente. The lyrics begin, "My father was from Rovno Gubernia." And not coincidentally, that's also Leonard Bernstein's father's hometown.
Okay, I confess, I made it up. It's my lyric, and my father was born in Rovna Gubernia, somewhere in the southern region of Russia, Ukraine. To be told.
My father came from Rovno Gubernia, but now I'm here, I'm dancing a tango. I am easily assimilated. I am so easily assimilated.
Around the same time, Leonard Bernstein was working on another musical theater piece. East Side Story had become West Side Story. Although the setting was now rival gangs in New York, the Italian Americans and the Puerto Rico Americans, there is still a hint of Jewish music in this work. Bernstein's third symphony is called Kaddish. Composed in 1963, it is based on the Hasidic story of the Berdichev Rebbe, who takes God to court, sues God for not holding up his end of the bargain to protect the Jewish people. In the marvel of chutzpah, the Rebbe confronts God. "We Jews have done everything you demanded of us, and look how you treat us." And at the end of his confrontation, the Rebbe chanted the traditional Kaddish. And Bernstein's Kaddish similarly calls God to account for the sorry state of the world.
"O my Father, ancient, hallowed, lonely, disappointed Father, rejected ruler of the universe, handsome, jealous Lord and lover, angry, wrinkled old majesty, I want to pray." I want to say Kaddish. My own Kaddish. Listen, Almighty, with all your might. There may just be no one to say it after me. Lord God of hosts, I call you to account. And don't shrug me off as if I were playing defiant daughter, your impudent rebel who could do with a slap. You know who I am. Ani chavatzelet hasharon. The lily that man has picked and thrown away. And you let this happen, Lord of hosts. You with your manna, your pillar of fire. You ask for faith. Where is your own? Why have you taken away your rainbow? That pretty bow you tied round your finger to remind you never to forget your...
In 1965, Bernstein took a sabbatical from the New York Philharmonic to give more time to composition. But it wasn't going well. The muse was evading him. He tried composing a musical based on Thornton Wilder's The Skin of Our Teeth, but it just wasn't working. Then he responded to an invitation to compose a choral work for the annual music festival in Chichester, England. The commission came from the very Reverend Walter Hussey, Dean of the Chichester Cathedral. The Reverend Hussey wrote, "Dear Mr. Bernstein, I hope you will forgive my writing to you and will not think me presumptuous. The choirs of Chichester, Salisbury, and Winchester cathedrals combine for a short festival each year. The Chichester organist and choirmaster, John Birch, and I are very anxious to have written some piece of music which the combined choirs could sing at the festival to be held in Chichester in August 1965, and we wondered whether by any chance you would be willing to write something for us. I hope you will feel quite free to write as you wish and will in no way feel inhibited by circumstances. I think many of us would be very delighted if there was a hint of West Side Story about the music." Bernstein responded, "My dear Dean Hussey, the only hitch is this. I can think of these psalms only in the original Hebrew. I am pleased with the work and hope you will be too. It is quite popular in feeling, even a hint, as you suggested, of West Side Story, and it has an old-fashioned sweetness along with its more violent moments." Bernstein wrote a poem about his sabbatical, which was published in the New York Times on Sunday, October 24, 1965. Here's an excerpt. "For hours on end I brooded and mused on materiae musicae used and abused, on aspects of unconventionality, over the death in our time of tonality. pieces for nattering, clucking sopranos, with squadrons of vibraphones, fleets of pianos, played with the forearms, the fists, and the palms. And then I came up with the Chichester Psalms. These psalms are a simple and modest affair, tonal and tuneful and somewhat square, certain to sicken a stout John Cager with its tonics and triads in E-flat major. But there it stands, the result of my pondering, 2 long months of avant-garde wandering, my youngest child old-fashioned and sweet, and he stands on his own 2 tonal feet. Okay, let's have a look at those 2 tonal feet. The work is in 3 movements and uses texts from 6 psalms. Bernstein insisted in his preface that the work be sung in the original Hebrew and may not be sung in any translation. You go, Lenny. Bernstein clearly knew his Hebrew. The mood of the music matches the sense of the lyrics. Listen to Ura Hanevel, Awaken the Heart. Listen to Hariu Ladonai Kol Haaretz, sing a joyful song to God, all of the lands. This God wrestling at the beginning of the 3rd movement, which reminds us a little bit of the Kaddish symphony, Anxiety. Is then followed by the calm of Lo Gavah Libi, my heart is not proud. And the serene Hine Matov, how wonderful it is when people can live together in peace. Now for the 2nd movement. It begins with an innocent setting of the pastoral poem from Psalm 23. But where did he get this music? From the cutting room floor of the failed Thornton Wilder musical, The Skin of Our Teeth, that Bernstein had been working on over the summer. Lenny was not one to waste resources. Now here's a song from that musical, The Skin of Our Teeth. Now, here's what the shepherd boy sings in the 2nd movement of Chichester Psalms. Then comes the unruly raging of the enemies from Psalm 2, Lama Rageshu Goyim. And that music was taken from the cutting room floor of West Side Story.
Mix, make a mess of them, make the sons of bitches pay, make a mess of them, make a mess of them.
Well, Chichester Psalms has become one of the most beloved choral orchestral works of the 20th century. To recap the composer's evaluation, these psalms are a simple and modest affair, tonal and tuneful and somewhat square, certain to sicken a stout John Cager with its tonics and triads in E-flat major. But there it stands, the result of my pondering, 2 long months of avant-garde wandering, my youngest child, old-fashioned and sweet, and he stands on his own 2 tonal feet. 1971 saw the premiere of Bernstein's Mass, which he composed for the opening of the Kennedy Center in Washington, D.C. Now you may say, whoa, wait a minute. The Jewish Bernstein and the Catholic Mass? Well, yes. First of all, while based on the Catholic liturgy, Bernstein added his own texts, challenging God and questioning faith. That's very Jewish, and in fact, harks back to Bernstein's Kaddish symphony. Plus, in the Sanctus section of the Mass, Bernstein added the Jewish version, the Kedusha, on which the Sanctus is based. In 1974, Bernstein composed a ballet based on the story of the Dibuk, an old Russian Jewish legend. In 1981, he composed Chalil. Now, Chalil means flute in Hebrew, and the work is dedicated, quote, to the spirit of Yadin Tenenbaum, an Israeli flute student killed in his tank close to the Suez Canal during the 1973 war. Then there is this song, Oif Mein Chasene, which is based on a Yiddish poem by Yankov Yitzchok Sigel. Now, it's just one movement from the arias and baccarolles of 1988. Let's listen to a little bit of it. Let me sum this up with a quotation from Bernstein's senior thesis from Harvard College called The Absorption of Race Elements into American Music. Quote, "It is easily understandable that a composer who is a second-generation American, whose parents were immigrants, still maintains a close contact with the old racial traditions. If the traditions are part of his childhood, they are inevitably part of his life." Bernstein had Aaron Copland in mind when he wrote that, but it certainly applies to the author himself. If the traditions are part of his childhood, they are inevitably part of his life. And Jewish identity was always an important element in the life and work of Leonard Bernstein.
Beautiful.
Is that it? It's over.
Thank you, everybody. I particularly appreciate everyone's patience with our technical difficulties at the beginning. And for those of you who have asked, yes, all of our online programs are available on our website. So if you missed any of it because you jumped in late or couldn't get in, you can always watch it from the beginning, probably by tomorrow. So feel free to let your friends and neighbors know, and anybody who couldn't get in tonight or still would like to see it again, that they can do so by going to the Zamir website. I also want to thank Gail Turman, our trusty woman behind the screen, ably supported by Kevin Martin. And of course, you'll hear from David Tilman shortly. And of course, Josh, for doing such a super job in letting us all know about the Jewish side of Leonard Bernstein. Just want to remind you, this has been a tough year for everybody, obviously. Zamir, we tried to keep our music going. We decided to bring it to your home since you couldn't come to us. And we have provided a year's worth of music free. And we want to express how appreciative we are to those who have donated. We hope everybody will continue to donate. It's the only way we can continue to bring the beauty of Jewish music into your home. You can go on our website and you could just go on the donate button, or you can purchase a face mask, or you can buy, and if you shop at on Amazon, Amazon donates a percentage of whatever you buy to Zamir. So you can go to that link also on the Zamir homepage. So thank you all very much for joining us this evening. And I'm going to turn it over to David for a little bit more Leonard Bernstein.
Unmute myself. Thank you very, very much. I'm so moved by this program tonight, by Josh's just inspiring and exquisite video. Of course, the material is so great, it's hard to mess up the material, but Josh combined it in such a passionate and meaningful way. So much so that I had a couple of recorded examples I was going to share with you, but I think that I let Josh's music and the selections he made stand on his own. And I just want to add a couple of comments based on my own experience. Now, I've been teaching Leonard Bernstein's music for the last 5 years. We should know that internationally from 2016 to 2018, the musical world, secular musical world, has been celebrating the Bernstein Centennial, and I was privileged to serve as a creative consultant at the National Museum of American Jewish History, where I immersed myself in this music and in the music of Leonard Bernstein. Of course, people of my era first were exposed to Leonard Bernstein in what was called the Young People's Concerts. I remember being about 11 or 12 years old on CBS when Leonard Bernstein appeared on the stage of Carnegie Hall with the New York Philharmonic in his role as music educator. And it was so spectacularly different than any other conductor that we had ever experienced. My childhood experience of a conductor on television was Arturo Toscanini, who was fiery and long, scraggly white hair and a big black coat. And on the stage in 1958 stepped this American-born and American-trained, dapper, articulate person, and proceeded to teach the seriousness of the musical enterprise in a series that went on for maybe 20 years, the Young People's Concerts. And they're worth looking for, and you can definitely, definitely find them. Much later in my academic career, I had the ultimate privilege of studying conducting with Mr. Abraham Kaplan. He should live and be well. He's 90 years old and he's doing fine in Baltimore. Mr. Kaplan was the choral conductor for all of Mr. Bernstein's choral works with the New York Philharmonic, including the premier recordings of the Chichester Psalms and the Kaddish Symphony. If you look on the albums, it says choral preparation, Abraham Kaplan, both in the performance here in the United States and the performance in Tel Aviv. And Mr. Kaplan, in my interactions with him, told me a couple of stories that I want to relate to you. Mr. Kaplan told me that when the New York Philharmonic was presenting the St. Matthew Passion, Mr. Bernstein, asked Mr. Kaplan to sit with his father, to sit with Samuel Bernstein during a performance of the St. Matthew Passion. St. Matthew Passion, we know, those of us that have experienced it, of course, has some very, very blatantly anti-Semitic statements about the Jews as the murderers of the Messiah. Mr. Bernstein felt that if Abe Kaplan would be sitting with his father, with Samuel Bernstein in the auditorium in the seats of Carnegie Hall, that would somehow make the experience more palatable, more kosher for Mr. Bernstein's father. Now, the great Jack Gottlieb, who is a Jewish scholar and a musician and served for many, many years as as an assistant to Mr. Bernstein in the New York Philharmonic, he has determined that there were 20 examples of where Leonard Bernstein took Jewish musical resources from his experience and from his background and plugged it into his music. 20, a huge number. Of course, the Chichester Psalms is reverse engineering, because in the Chichester Psalms, Mr. Bernstein wrote the melody, which we heard earlier in Josh's video, particularly the melody of the 23rd Psalm. And for many of us who have sung the Chichester Psalms many, many times, that becomes the melody, Mr. Bernstein's melody, for the way we sing the 23rd Psalm. Mr. Bernstein kind of Judaized that melody by making his melody the signature melody for the 23rd Psalm. Now, as we look at these 20 places where Mr. Bernstein put Jewish musical sources, in my work, in the teaching that I've done on this theme, I kind of organize them in three categories. One, music written for the Jewish community. Hashkiveinu, Simchuna, Yigdal. These are pieces that are overtly Jewish. Two, music written for the general public, for which the Jewish sources are clear and out front, like the Jeremiah Symphony, like the Kaddish Symphony. And then three, music where the Jewish material is hidden and it's revelation, it's finding it, undiscovering it, is source of joy and discovery. And Josh showed us some of those. Candide, the old lady's Jewish tango, Moderato Hasidicamente, the shofar sounds in West Side Story, the Hebrew quotes in the Sanctus Mass, and of course, finally, in the Chichester Psalms, the reverse, where Mr. Bernstein's melody for the 23rd Psalm became the signature melody for so many of us who have spent many, many rehearsals and many, many concerts learning and mastering the Chichester Psalms. Now, I want to tell you a little story in my own background that relates to the end of his life. Mr. Bernstein died much too young. He died in 1990 at the age of 72. His last conducting was in Tanglewood in the summer of 1990, and he could barely get off the stage. He was so out of breath. And he said that he would continue to teach and to study and to be a scholar, but he could no longer conduct. Just prior to that, he was interviewed at Tanglewood, and he made a very interesting quote. He said that the composers don't consider me a real composer. The pianists don't consider me a real pianist. And the conductors don't consider me a real conductor. But he was all of that, and so much more for people of our time. What he also was what we call eclectic. At a time when musicians were very, very focused and very single-minded, he could do it all. He could play the piano, he could conduct, he could teach, he could speak, he could educate, he could write popular music, and he could write serious classical music. Finally, let me tell you a beautiful story in my own background from 1986, 4 years before he died. Mr. Bernstein was and remains the honored graduate of the Curtis Institute in Philadelphia, where I live. And in 1986, the Curtis Institute was celebrating its, I believe, 60th anniversary of its founding. And they brought back Maestro Bernstein as their honored alumnus for a month of concerts. And at that time, Mr. Bernstein presented all the symphonies and small recitals and, of course, the Chichester Psalms with a large chorus and a large orchestra of students from the Curtis Institute on the stage of the Academy of Music, which is where the major concerts took place at that time in Philadelphia. I was very coincidentally working on a performance of the Chichester Psalms in my own congregation at Beth Shalom Congregation in Elkins Park. And I made a couple of phone calls and made a contribution to the alumni organization at the Curtis Institute. And I was able to get about 20 of my own singers from the Beth Shalom Chorale into the rehearsal at the Curtis Institute, a rehearsal for the Chichester Psalms at the Academy of Music. And he didn't look well. He looked haggard, he looked tired, he looked unkempt by comparison to his dapper nature and his polished nature of years before. And I sat there in the second row watching the first half of the rehearsal, and then came the break. Now, in orchestra rehearsals, there's always a 15, 20 minute break in the first half and second half. And I knew the backstage area at the Academy of Music, and I immediately ran backstage to meet Mr. Bernstein. And I found my way back there, and he was standing against the wall on the stage all by himself, all alone. And I went right up to him, told him who I was, told him where I had studied, told him where I had worked. And in my own career, my first position was as the Chazan Sheni, the Park Avenue Synagogue, where Mr. Bernstein had a long-term relationship with Chazan Putterman based on his writing of the Hashkivenu so many, many years before. And I told Maestro Bernstein that I was working on a performance of the Chichester Psalms, which is going to be in about 5 weeks away. And he said, well, of course, you're doing the smaller version, aren't you? And we should note for the record that there are two versions of the Chichester Psalms. The choral score, the 18 and a half measures, 18 and a half minutes, the three movements that Josh talked about earlier, stays the same. What is different is the accompaniment. The orchestral accompaniment for the Chichester Psalms, as written for the Chichester Abbey in 1965, is the one that is performed most of the time by symphony orchestras. You need a large orchestra with no woodwinds, but a lot of percussion and two harps and full strings, and it requires some resources to have an orchestra like that. Mr. Bernstein, with great seichel, on his own, with no help, sat down and took his Chichester Psalms and wrote a reduced orchestration for the Chichester Psalms. The reduced orchestration consists of only three players, three virtuoso players. You need a virtuoso pipe organ player, you need a virtuoso percussion player to play a whole battery of instruments, and you need a virtuoso harpist. And those three players are able to capture the spirit of the Chichester Psalms. So when Maestro Bernstein said to me, of course you're doing the smaller version, he meant, well, of course you're doing the smaller orchestration. And I looked him in the eye, and he was, the TV lets everybody think that he was a tall man, but he wasn't really. He was no more than an inch or two taller than I was, and he looked me right in the eye. And I said, I looked him in the eye and I said, Maestro, no, I'm doing the full version, the large version of your Chichester Psalms. He took his hands, he took both of his hands, and he grabbed my face and he went, "Atta boy!" Just like that. And I was both flustered and very, very excited. I didn't shave for 3 days after that. And I was so moved by that experience. And I considered that to be that attaboy moment, which I treasure to this day, to be his blessing to me and to all of us Jewish musicians, to take Maestro Bernstein's music, study it, analyze it, make it part and parcel of who we are as American Jews. Let me just show you the two books to read. There's so many books about Bernstein that we should know about, but the two that I would recommend, if you have time, is this one, which is a massive volume. It's called Leonard Bernstein by Humphrey Burton, who was an Englishman who worked with Bernstein for many, many years. An encyclopedic book, wonderful book, and very, very well written. And then a more recent one was written by Bernstein's firstborn child, his daughter Jamie. And this is a book called Famous Father Girl. a memoir of growing up Bernstein with Lenny up here and Jamie right here, with all kinds of family anecdotes, including stories of his Jewish background and his siddurim, the Pesach siddurim, and that he ran for his family, and in his role in the American Jewish community. I am again so honored to have participated with my colleague Josh Jacobson, and so pleased to have been invited to participate. And I thank you so much for this opportunity. And if there are questions or comments, now is the time, and I'll turn it back to Barbara and Gail to preside at this point.